Sahana. तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति 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 हरि ॐ सो वी आर नाउ स्टडीइंग शंकराचार्यस कमेंट्री ऑन द ब्रह्म सूत्रस वी आर नाउ स्टडीइंग हिज कमेंट्री ऑन द थर्ड सूत्र सो नाउ वी सी वन ऑफ द वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ this discussion which Shankaracharya brings oft quoted portion of his commentary. Yesterday we saw what is the difference between the means of knowledge used for Brahma Jigyasa and those that are used for Dharma Jigyasa. Now Shankaracharya is going to talk about the logic behind the means of knowledge which are used for Dharma Jigyasa, for the inquiry into Dharma. Dharma again here meaning Dharma as defined in Mimamsa Sutras. That means the performance of sacrificial rites as prescribed by the Vedas. So he says, Kartum Akartum, Anyathava Akartum, Cha Shakyam, Laukikam, Vedikam, Cha Karma. Kartum, akartum, anyathava kartum cha shakyam, laukikam, vaidikam cha karma. That means, what is laukikam, vaidikam, karma? What is the action which is vaidikam, which is prescribed by the Vedas? Or what is the action which is laukikam, worldly? So, what is the nature of such action? The action is kartum, you can do to perform, you are able to perform it. Akartum, you are able to abstain from performing it, means you are able to not perform it. And anyathava kartum, you are able to perform it in a different way. So, any action which is worldly action or which is a scriptural action is characterized by these qualities that either you can perform or you may not perform or you might perform in a different way. So, suppose you want to say, we will take the example of a worldly action. Suppose you want to from Chennai go to Delhi. So, you can either go or you cannot, you might not go, or if your friend has suggested that you take a train, you may instead take a flight. Anyathava kartu. So either you can do it or you may abstain from doing it or you choose not to do it or you can do it in a different way. And kartum, akartum, anyathava kartum, shakyam, cha shakyam, laukikam, vaidikam, cha karma. So you are able to perform it, kartum, akartum, you are able to abstain from performing it or you decide not to perform it and you decide to perform it in a different manner. Anyathava kartu. Shakyam. So it is possible to do such a action in this way and that is why these three options are available as far as it is action concerning Vedas or what has been prescribed by Vedas or just any worldly action. Yatha Ashvena gachati. Ashvena gachati. Padbhyam anyathava. Nava gachati iti. So, I gave a different example. I told you, if you want to go to Delhi from Chennai, you can, a person who is suggesting may suggest you take a train, you may instead take a flight, etc. Here, the example which is given here is, one can Ashvena gachati, one can take a horse, one can ride by a horse, or padbhyam gachati, one can go on foot, or anyathava, or one can go some other method, one can take a chariot or something, or nava gachati, may not go also. So, so this is like that. Similarly, tatha Atiratre Shodashinam Grihnati. So in the Maitrayani Samhita, it is told that Shodashin means, Shodashinam means it is the 16th number, 16th cup. So Atiratre, in the sacrifice which is called Atiratra, one may take, or one may take up. Grihnati means to take up. So one may take up the 16th number of cup. And then na atira, this is there. Then there is another option is there. Na atiratre shodashinam grihnati. That one might not take the 16th cup in the performance of atiratra. Similarly, another very famous example which is given is udite juhoti. That is, one can do a sacrifice which is Agnihotra sacrifice, that is Udite Juhoti. As soon as there is sunrise, one should do the sacrifice. And Anudite Juhoti, and one can do sacrifice before the sunrise. So there are two options. One should offer. What happened?
No, Maharaj, there was a power cut, sir.
Yeah,
it's all
but,
right.
But what was he asking and what were you saying?
No. It's like for a different reason. Yeah.
Juhoti, that means in Agnihotra, there is the option given. Udite Juhoti, Anudite Juhoti. Now the question is, you have to do the Agnihotra sacrifice before sunrise, Udite, or just after sunrise. So Udite Juhoti means after sunrise. Anudite Juhoti means before sunrise. Means Suryasya Udite. Surya Udite. So when the sun rises, you do offer this oblation of Agnihotra sacrifice. Or when the sun has not risen yet, you do this sacrifice. So here you see, in these kind of cases, iti vidhi pratishedatcha atra arthavantahasyu vikalpa utsarga apavadascha. So vidhi pratishedaha shedaha iti vidhi pratishedahascha. Vidhi means injunction, pratisheda means prohibition. So in the Vedic scriptures, in the Vedas, we find two kinds of sentences. One is injunction, another one is prohibition, vidhi pratisheda. Atra arthavantaha syu. So they become very meaningful here. Why? Though, see, it might apparently sound meaningless that you are saying that you can offer the oblation before the sunrise. Then at the second time you are saying you can offer the, you should, it is not you can, you should offer the oblation after the sunrise. Then immediately you are saying you should offer the oblation before the sunrise. So similarly, you are saying in Atiratra you should take the 16th cup, then you are saying you should not take the 16th cup. So this may come out as something which is meaningless, but that is what Shankaracharya makes it clear. He says vidhi pratishedaha cha iti vidhi pratishedaha cha. All these prohibitions and injunctions, atra, here, arthavantasyuhu, they become meaningful. They are meaningful. Why? Vikalpa utsarga apavadascha. Because they denote the options, vikalpa, different alternatives. Utsarga, general rules, and apavada, exceptions. So they are meaningful because they are general rules, or they are different alternative given for different circumstances, or they are exceptions, as the case may be in the specific example. So here what is being told, here it is being told that you see, in any kind of Vedic sacrifice or Vedic ritual, or in any kind of worldly activity, you have option to do it, not to do it, or to do it in a different way. And why the Shruti is being quoted, why the Vedas are being quoted, that this is not an option. Somebody should not misunderstand this as Suppose the Veda says Agni Hotram Juhuyat, that you have to perform Agni Hotra sacrifice. Somebody should not take it mistakenly that Kartum Akartum Anyathava Kartum means that even the Veda says you might or might not do it. That is not what is intended here. That is why the scriptures have been quoted to prove that the Vedas themselves give you an option. It is not that you decide that I will do or I will not do. That is true for the worldly activity. But as far as Vedic activity is concerned, Vedas themselves give you an option of doing it or not doing it or doing it in another way. And so this shows that it is important, that shows that it is important that scriptures and worldly knowledge be taken as the means of knowledge. Yesterday we saw that for dharma, dharma jigyasa, we take anubhava, experience, and we take shruti adayaha, we take scriptures, that is the Veda, Shruti, and also Smriti, etc., as the pramana, means of knowledge for dharma jigyasa. Now the logic, why do we do so, is being told here. Because in the daily experience, we see so many things. So according to the circumstances, according to the resources available, we have to make a decision. And so as far as dharma jigyasa is concerned, as far as the inquiry into dharma is concerned, we take as valid means of knowledge Shruti, Smriti, and also experience. Now in the next paragraph, Shankaracharya says, what will be, obviously the logical next thing will be to go to Brahma Pramana Vishaya Yukti. So now we saw what are the means of knowledge. Yesterday we saw for Dharma Jigyasa. We also saw what are the means of knowledge for Brahma Jigyasa. Now we have to see the rationale, the logic behind the means of knowledge for Dharma Jigyasa we saw just now. And now we will see what is the logic for Brahma Jigyasa. What is the logic for Brahma Jigyasa? The means of knowledge for Brahma Jigyasa. So Brahma Pramana. Pramana means of knowledge. Vishaye, regarding that, Yuktihi, rational. What is the rational? Natu vastu, evam, na evam, asti, nasti, itiva, vikalpyate. Natu, but, tu means but here. Natu, but. Vastu, that is an existing entity. So we saw that yesterday, in the case of Brahma Jigyasa, we saw that because there is vastu, bhuta vastu vishayatvat, it deals with something which is already existing, some entity which is already existing. So that is why we have to take recourse to scriptures as the means of knowledge, and also to anubhava, experience, as a means of knowledge. Now here we are seeing that a vastu which is existing, an entity which is existing, that cannot be told as, see, earlier a means of doing something. Okay, suppose you have to perform a sacrifice. It is a process. It is a method of doing a sacrifice. That can be kartum, either you do it, akartum, or you don't do it, anyathava kartum, or you do it in a different manner. But here, we are not talking about any sacrifice. We are talking about Brahma, as experienced by everyone through Atman. Okay, so here we cannot say evam, that exists, na evam, that it does not exist, asti, that it exists. Evam means it is like this, na evam, it is not like this, or asti, it exists, or nasti, it does not exist. You cannot talk like that when you are talking about the existence of an entity. It is okay to talk like that when you are talking about method of doing something, performing something, but you cannot say Bipul is there. Then Bipul is there. You cannot say Bipul is there, he is not there, he can be somewhere else also. You can say, then you will be labeled as a mad person, but normal people cannot say like that. You cannot say that. So either you are there or either you are like that. You cannot say Bipul is 10 feet tall and he is also 5 feet tall. It cannot be. Either so evam, naivam. So either this way or that is the way. There can be only one way for an entity which exists. Okay. So itiva vikalpyat natu vastu evam naivam asti nasti itiva vikalpyate. So you cannot, any existing entity, bhuta vastu, cannot be referred to in an optional manner. I went to the room, I saw Sirin. Then you say, no, I did not see Sirin. Oh, I saw Sirin, she was sitting in a chair. Oh no, I saw Sirin sitting on the table. It cannot, all cannot be simultaneous. Only either of these statements can be true. So, then it is told, vikalpana tu purusha buddhi apekshaha. All these options, vikalpa, are all dependent on purusha buddhi, human intellect. See, all these options are dependent on human intellect. How? Suppose you see an entity. Suppose there is a colorblind person. The person goes and sees something which is green, but cannot understand it is green. The person says, I saw something which is blue. But there is nothing something which is blue. Another person goes and says, I saw something which is green. So that means this depends on the person's intellect. And because this person's intellect, because of some nervous neurological problem, does not have the faculty of understanding the color green, finds out to be a color blue. So this depends on what? Purusha buddhi apekshaha. Purusha buddhi apeksha. That means it depends on the human intellect. Okay. Natu vastu yathatmya jnanam purusha buddhi apekshyam. It's a very important concept. So this particular portion, both Dharma Jigyasa and Brahma Jigyasa, the Pramana Vishaya Yukti, is very important. Even if someone memorizes it, it will be very nice. What does he say here? He say, you see, all these options, all these alternatives we are talking about, they all depend on Purusha Buddhi. They all depend on human intellect. But, Natu Vastu Yathatmya Jnanam. Yathatmya means real nature. Vastu means an existing entity. Jnanam means knowledge. So the knowledge of the real nature of an existing entity, natu, not at all, purusha buddhi apeksham, depend on human intellect. So you see, very simple. You may see some object and you may cognize or you may think that it is of a particular shape, particular color, etc. But what it really is not dependent on what you think it to be. It's a very important concept. So Sri Ramakrishna, in his very beautiful, inimitable style, he says that there is a creature living on that tree and a person goes below it and sees it to be green. Another fellow sees it to be brown or something, so many colors. And then they find a person who lives under the tree and they ask him, what is this creature? What is its true color? And he says, you are all correct. It has got all these colors, but it has also sometimes colorless. So that is chameleon. So chameleon is sometimes of all these colors, but it can be also like colorless. So what is the true nature of chameleon? Only the chameleon has the knowledge, or only chameleon will know. nobody who sees a chameleon can understand its true nature. So the true nature of chameleon does not depend on human intellect. That is what is told. So any existing entities, yathatmya jnana, knowledge of its true nature does not depend on human intellect. So if we just extend it a bit, then we can understand that yes, then the knowledge of Atman also, which is the true nature of existing entity, which we are all, does not depend on human intellect, because human intellect perceives everything through some medium. And so if the medium is corrupt, the intellect will also have a corrupted knowledge of that thing. So that is why you see something with a tainted glass, with a glass with some color of tinted glass, then you will see all the things with that tint. Okay, so we see everything with the tint of ignorance. We see everything with the tint of ignorance. Sri Ramakrishna uses this very nice example. A person who is suffering from jaundice sees everything yellowish. So everything with the tint of ignorance. And so, natu vastu yathatmya jnanam purusha buddhi apeksham. So the knowledge of the true nature of an existing entity does not at all depend on the human intellect. Kim tarhi, then again question is, tarhi then, kim what then means what then, on what does it depend? The knowledge, true knowledge of an existing entity does not depend on human intellect. Then on what does it depend? That is the question. Kim tarhi vastu tantram eva. So here two concepts are brought. One is purusha tantram, that means the intellect of the human being, and vastu tantram, that means, tantram means here dependence. So the knowledge, true knowledge of an entity is dependent on that entity itself. Vastu tantram eva. So it is dependent on the entity itself. How, what is the true nature of chameleon depends on the chameleon itself. What is the true nature of Atman depends on the Atman itself. So vastu tantram eva tat, that, na, not, he, indeed. So it is dependent on vastu only, the entity only, but that is not, indeed it is not, ekasmin sthanau sthanuhu va purushah anyah va iti. So you see, in a dark place, or when we see from far, we don't know whether it is a pillar or it is a person who is standing afar. Okay, we don't know whether it is a sthanu, means a pillar or post, or whether it is a purusha, whether it is a human being. We don't know. From a distance, both, particularly in a kind of a dark kind of a situation, both appear same. We just can see some perpendicular thing there. So we don't know whether it is a post or whether it is a person. Now, this iti tattva jnanam bhavati. So here, nahi. So this cannot be a valid cognition. Means cognition or the knowledge of something perpendicular in a dark kind of a scene, atmosphere, very far away, where you have a doubt whether it is a post or a tree or a person, cannot be a valid cognition. What will be a valid cognition? When you know for sure what it is. So here it is not certain. You don't know certain for certain what it is. So this is not a valid cognition. It is not. So sthanuhu, ekasmin sthanu, with respect to a particular place, sthanuhu, or particular post, sthanau means a particular post here. So there is a pillar or a post kind of thing. And with respect to that, your knowledge that either it can be sthanuhu va purushah va, it can be either a person or it can be a post. That is not a iti tattva jnanam nahi bhavati. It can never be valid cognition. It cannot be valid cognition because you don't know for sure what it is. Tatra purushaha anyaha va iti mithya jnanam. So there, the knowledge that it is either a person or something else is a wrong knowledge. So suppose there is a post, sthano, that is what it says. Ekasmin sthano, there is a post to a pillar. And from afar and in a poor lighting condition, you think that it can be a post or it can be a person also. That is not valid knowledge. It is not tattva jnanam. It is not valid cognition. And to think that instead of valid cognition, it is quite the opposite. To think that it can be a post or a person, it is a mithya jnanam. It is a false cognition. It is a false cognition, mithya jnanam. It is wrong. It is not only not valid, it is wrong. Because why it is wrong? Because that post is actually a post. There is only post. But you are thinking that it could be a person also. Either it is a post or a person or something else. So when you say this is a person or something else, see, because it is a post, the cognition that it is a person or something else, the very idea that it is a person or something else is wrong cognition, false cognition, because it is only post. So earlier we had three options, that it could be a post, it could be a person, or it could be something else. And those options or that kind of a cognition or knowledge is called an invalid cognition. It is not tattva jnana. Because actually it is a post, but you are thinking it could be a post, it could be a person or something else. And the knowledge that it could be a person or something else is actually a false knowledge. Because there, what actually there it is a post. It's a pillar. And sthanuhu eva iti tattva jnanam. What is valid cognition? That it is post. It is definitely post. It is nothing else but post. When you get that kind of a knowledge, that is valid cognition, not anything else. So even to think that it is either a post or a person or something else is an invalid cognition. To think that it is either a person or something else, where actually it is a post, is false cognition. False. It is mithya, because these two things are not there. And to think that it is indeed only a post, definitely it is only a post, that is correct cognition, or that is tattva jnanam, valid cognition. So why this is being told? Valid cognition about any existing entity cannot be two or three. It can be only one. See, you cannot have alternatives in the valid cognition of an existing entity. There can be no alternative. Unlike in the method of doing something, where we told kartum, akartum, anyatha kartum va. So there you can do, you cannot, you might not do, or you may do it in some different manner. But as far as an entity is concerned, it is always only one knowledge, one combination is valid cognition. So vastu tantratvat, and why is it so? Because it is dependent on the entity. Why is it that only one cognition is correct? Because it is dependent on the entity. It is not dependent on the purusha or the person. It's a very important concept, you have to understand it. So vastu tantratvat evam, thus bhuta vastu vishayanam, that means of the cognition or the perception which have as their subject vishaya, content, bhuta vastu, existing entity. So any cognition which has existing entity as its subject, pramanyam vastu tantram, so for them the pramanyam or the authenticity, validity is Vastu Tantram, is dependent on the entity itself. So all the cognitions, which are cognitions of existing entity, their authenticity depends on the entity itself. So suppose there is a magician, like P.C. Sarkar once did, he simply vanished one whole train. So now people said there is no train, but it is wrong because the train is there. The train itself is the authenticity. Now what is the proof? Proof is the train itself. Because the train is existing, people were inside the train, they were always there, they did not go anywhere. So the train itself is proof that the train exists. Okay, the post itself is proof that the post exists. Similarly, Atman itself is the proof that Atman exists. That is why we say Swata Siddha, Swata Pramana, self existing, Swata Siddha, self, what do you call it? Siddha means self authentication. So it is self-evident. That is the word it's used. Self-evident. Swata Siddha. Swata Pramana. So it's self-evident. You don't need any other evidence from outside. So that concept you have to understand. So that is why it is Vastu Tantra, not Purusha Tantra. Okay. So Tatra Evam Sati. So there, in this circumstance, evam sati, this being the case, brahma jnanam api, knowledge of Brahman also, vastu tantram eva, it is dependent on entity alone. What is the entity here? Brahman. So the knowledge of Brahman is dependent on Brahman. It is not dependent on scriptures. It is not dependent on anubhava. So that is the logic of the means of knowledge. So you see, though you study the scriptures, by scriptures study, you cannot realize the knowledge of Brahman. Why? Because it is not dependent on scriptures. It is self-evident. It is dependent on itself. Vastu Tantra Meva. Bhuta Vastu Vishayatvat. Why? Because it concerns or it is about a thing which is already existing. It is an existing entity. So that is why it has to be Vastu Tantram. It depends on the entity itself. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat. So you have any questions for this, whatever it is?
Yeah, one question, Maharaj. So, in the whole person example, there can be three stages of understanding. In the first stage, I think it is a person. Second stage, say, I read the scriptures and I know that, yes, I am seeing the person, but I may be wrong because scripture is telling me that pole is there behind the person. Okay. And third stage is when I know for sure pole is there. So what I understand that the first two are called false knowledge, but isn't stage two also like some kind of pratibhasika satya, that I know that okay, my mind and intellect is not pure, the scripture is telling me otherwise. Like, can we directly say that it is false, or it is just true to me?
Actually, you have read too much into the example. The example was not like this. So the example does not at all talk about Brahma Jnana. The example is just an empirical example. It's just an example about seeing a pole or a post. Okay. So it is not at all about any knowledge of Brahman or anything. And there are not two stages or three stages. It is talking about different kinds of cognition or knowledge of a pole. What are the different knowledge which can happen? One knowledge is that you, and this pole is little far away and in poor lighting conditions. Otherwise you will see it is a pole. Okay. So when that happens, what are the two, three kind of possibilities? One is that you are in doubt. You think that it could be a pole, it could be a person, or it could be something else, like it could be a tree also. So you have these options in your mind, these alternatives. So here we are not at all talking about Brahma Jnana. We are talking about just seeing a pole. It's just an empirical experience. But because of the distance and because of the poor lighting, you think either it could be a pole or it could be a person or it could be something else. When you think like that, that it could be a pole or it could be a person or it could be something else, this knowledge is an invalid knowledge. Because it is only a pole. It is neither a person or neither something else. So this cognition is invalid. Okay, it is not valid. Okay, because it is not that. Second possibility is that you think that it is a person or something else. Means you don't think that it is a pole at all. You think that it is a person or something else. That is a false knowledge. Why it is a false knowledge? Because it does not include the possibility of a valid knowledge. If you were thinking that either it could be a pole or a person or something else, even then there is this pole, which it actually is. So, but in the second alternative, both your alternatives are false. That is why it is called false knowledge. Because it is neither a person nor something else. Okay. And in the third alternative, you say that no, it is pole. So please don't sublate it or don't confuse it with the knowledge of Brahman. Here we are not at all talking about knowledge of Brahman. Here we are just giving an example of seeing a pole from afar and in poor lighting conditions, which could create three alternatives of three kinds of cognition. And it is being told that because first cognition contains the possibility of the valid cognition, it can be called as invalid. Because even there, why it is invalid? Because the validity is not certain. You are not saying yes, it is pole. You are giving options for two other kind of possibilities. So it is not valid. And the second one is completely false because you are saying that it is a person or something else, which it is not. And the third knowledge is only certain knowledge, which is that it is pole. So now, why is this example being given? This example is being given to tell you that the knowledge, true knowledge of the entity here in our example pole depends on the pole itself. It does not depend on the Purusha, because Purusha can have three alternatives. You see these three alternatives. Purusha means the person, because of bad lighting and also distance. So that is why, similarly, the knowledge of Brahman depends on Brahman itself. So here you should not confuse that with different stages of knowing and all that. That would not work out.
No, I was thinking like, suppose I'm observing an apple. So first knowledge is I think it is an apple. Second is I read scriptures and I know that, okay, though I am seeing an apple, there is Brahman behind it, which is powering it for me to see that it is an apple and perceive that it is an apple. And third stage is I perceive Brahman even in that apple, or like it is Brahman everywhere. I don't see the difference between the apple and me. So in that context, I was asking that, can we say that the second stage is false knowledge? Or
so that is what I'm saying. That is what I'm saying. Then that is your example. So in that example, nobody is saying that the second is false, the third is false. Then the question of this being a false knowledge does not arise at all. Because that labeling of invalid cognition or false cognition or valid cognition is specifically for this example. Okay, so when you put it like that, then I would not call it false or something. See, then it becomes something completely different. Is it not? It is completely different, because what you are talking about here is completely different. And also, when you see an apple, it is not being powered by Brahman or something like that. There is only Brahman. Because of ignorance, you see apple. You may think that it is a very silly thing to point out, but no, because the understanding is completely different. Okay, so it's not that somebody is powering it from behind so that it appears as apple. No, there is no powering and there is no person who is powering and there is nothing which is getting powered. This dichotomy or difference in conception should go. There is no bedha bedhi. This bedha bedhi, this is not there. One who is creating difference and one that is being differentiated. It is not there in Advaita Vedanta. So, yeah, but again, as I said, that example is your example, so that example does not have the labels of invalid cognition, false cognition, or valid cognition. That is only for this empirical example, worldly example, there no Brahman Dharman is coming. So don't confuse. See, that is what we have to be very careful. We should not take one example and try to put some other things, interpolate, extrapolate. Shankaracharya never does that. Because if you do it, everything gets washed up. So clarity of thinking demands that you see an example only in that narrow sense. That is why in Sanskrit there is one adage, Udaharana Ekadeshiya, that all examples are only very specific. You cannot start interpreting examples in as many ways as you like. Udaharana Ekadeshiya. It is just, it can address only one particular point of the discussion. So here the example is a purely empirical example, purely worldly example. There is no spirituality or Brahman or anything coming here. And that example is given to show that how the knowledge of anything, any entity which exists, depends on that entity. That is why I gave you the example of coming here, which is Sri Ramakrishna's example. Any other question you have? Okay.
No, I had a similar question, but now you said that the example should be treated independently, because what I was thinking was the pole, the person is able to, there are two components here. One is the environment factor, which is the low lighting or the distance or both of them. And the second one is my state of mind or whatever. It means I might be waking up and suddenly seeing something and creating that kind of impression. So there are two factors here in this particular example. Right? The pole is misconstrued that way. So if one of them is improved, for example, my lighting condition or the distance is improved, I get a little more clarity. Right.
Yeah.
So coming of the scriptures, whether scriptures will help me or not. So I think that that's why that you clarified that, but that's why I'm not trying to connect.
So yeah. So scriptures we should not connect. And as far as the worldly example is concerned, you see, even if the lighting is improved or your mind is improved, mental state is improved, etc., that is what Shankaracharya is telling. You see, if this is improved or not improved or any state, it is the fact that there is a pole remains. The fact that there is a pole remains. Even if there is, like suppose there is mist, you cannot see, or you are able to see it clearly even from a distance, whatever it may be, even if you are seeing it, even if you are seeing it partially, unable to see it, or you are seeing it more clearly, the fact that the pole remains is not changing at all. Why? Because it depends on the fact that the pole remains. So that is why I give this example. Of course, many people have given it as an example in scriptures. That how do we know, which of course Shankaracharya also gave in Adhyasa Bhasha, how do we know that Brahman exists? Because I perceive, I feel happiness. And also this concept of I is there, this feeling, consciousness of I is there. Even a person with complete amnesia has got this consciousness of I. So the very fact that this exists shows that there is something which exists. You don't need any other evidence. The very evidence that it exists, that this I exists, is evidence enough to show that Atman exists. That is the idea. Okay. So that is why. So here that is what is Vastu Tantra. This concept is Purusha Tantra, Vastu Tantra. So the fact that you can do things in your own way, or that you have all these kind of alternatives, is the thing which is dependent on the doer. Kartum, akartum, anyatha va kartum. Whether I will do it, I will not do it, I will do it in another way, depends on the doer. That means on the person, human being. Whereas the fact that a pole is there or not does not depend on the doer. It depends on the object, the entity. The entity. Vastu Tantra. So this you have to understand. Purusha Tantra, Vastu Tantra. And so Brahma Jnana also is Vastu Tantra. It depends on the entity itself. Okay, so nice. We will meet again tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Yeah.